So now, let's say you had some arbitrary network N, which had everything, RLC, and you can also include control sources if you wish, but you had some RLC, and the input is some VP exponential, sorry, the input is VP cross omega t plus phi. I could do this with exponential ST, but I don't want to do it right now. In fact, in networks and systems, that's what you will do, and every component will have a value which is a function of S. Just like here for the capacitor, we had that 1 by SC, which looked like some resistance, right? So we'll have that, but in this case we'll do everything with sinusoids or complex exponentials where the frequency is imaginary. Okay, and so this is the circuit that I want to calculate the solution for. Solution for meaning maybe I want to find every branch voltage and every branch current. Okay, so how do we do it? First of all, we use the standard trick of instead of using this as the input, we'll use VP exponential j phi exponential j omega t. Okay, that's been our standard thing to do. Now, because we have only real valued components inside, I calculate the solution to this, and let's say I have some branch current or branch voltage, I take the real part of that, that will be the solution to that. Okay, this part everybody is clear about? We got that simply by superposition, right? I mean, we didn't do any arbitrary thing like just taking the real part or something. We superposed cos omega t plus phi and sin omega t plus phi with different weighting factors. So that became this. The only reason to use this is the solution to this is a lot easier to calculate than that one. Okay. So then we find the real parts. So now let's say I have some elements. Let's not worry about exactly what they are right now. There'll be some loop in the circuit. Let me call them element maybe. Elements A, B, and C. Okay. So now, what will be the general form of the voltage VA for this input? Constant times. What is the general form of VA for this case, with this this complex exponential as the input? It will be some VA will be some complex number, okay. I will denote it like that, or maybe I shouldn't do this, but let's say I use lowercase VA to denote the voltage, and that will be, this is just a complex constant, okay, times exponential j omega t. Right, it's going to be like this for sure. Why? Because it's a linear network and it satisfies some linear differential equation. It could be immensely complicated, but whatever it is, if the forcing function is exponential j omega t, then like every the exponential j omega t will satisfy the differential equation with some scaling factor. Okay, we won't worry about what that is. We'll just denote the amplitude by some complex number. Okay. This is the forced response, okay? This is only the forced response. The forced response does not depend on the initial condition. Is that, that's why I clarified that earlier, okay? The natural response will depend on the forcing function, but the forced response by definition does not depend on the initial conditions, yes? If the input is exponential j omega t, the every voltage and current will be exponential j omega t times something. Is that okay? So that's all. That's all I'm saying. Okay.
So you said that the VA will be a complex number.
Yeah.
So in order to be a scale version, it should be like it cannot be any complex number. It should be some constant in the VP will be.
Ah yeah, that is okay. That we'll calculate later. Okay.
That will be the case.
Yeah, yeah, that will be the case because if the input is some exponential j omega t, all the voltages will be something times that exponential j omega t, right? And the fact that it scales with Vp comes from linearity. Okay, that also I mentioned earlier. The force response scales with the forcing function. Okay, so that will also be the case. What we are looking for is an easy way to calculate VA without going into the differential equation. Okay. No, no, this is, we are looking at the solution to this one. Okay. So I'm not looking at, I don't worry about this anymore. Okay, because I know how to do that. If I have Vp cos omega t plus phi, I will calculate the solution to Vp exponential j omega t plus phi. Okay, and I'll calculate any quantity I want, any branch voltage or current, and I'll take the real part of it. Okay, that taking the real part comes at the end. Okay. So this Va is, so let me be explicit here, forced response to Vp exponential j omega t plus phi, which I have written as some scaling factor, some complex scaling factor times exponential j omega t. Okay, you will see very soon why I did that. Okay, and what will be the form of Vb? What is that? Some complex number times also exponential j omega t. Okay, and we see obviously you expect the same thing, some other complex number. We don't know what these complex numbers are, but it will be of this form. Is this convincing or not? Is this okay? Okay, fine. Similarly, if I have a node with, let's say I'll take three elements connected, and I take ID, IE, and IF. Okay, ID will be some complex number exponential j omega t, IE will be some other complex number exponential j omega t, and IF will be yet another complex number exponential j omega t. Is this okay? Everything will be exponential j omega t times something, and that something can be a complex number. That's all I have written so far. Okay. Is this fine? So this is true of every voltage and every current in the circuit. It will be some complex number times exponential j omega t. Okay. Now clearly around every loop KVL is obeyed, right? Nothing controversial about that. So Va plus Vb plus Vc equals zero. Okay. Right? Yes. This is, we are talking only about the forced response. Okay. Why? Why is it not obeyed for forced response? Yeah. No, the natural response will have exponential minus t by rc or something, right? The natural modes of the system. Okay. This exponential j omega t can never cancel that. KVL has to be obeyed for the forced response and the natural response individually, isn't it? Just to simplify the situation now, let's assume that the natural response has died out. Every circuit for which this calculation is useful, okay, we'll see that calculating only the forced response is useful. That's because the natural response will die out after some time. So the natural response everywhere will die out, and you will be left with only the forced response. So you can imagine that we are calculating it in that situation where the natural response has become negligible. Now the other point is that the force response will have exponential j omega t. The natural response will have the natural modes of the system. Let's say exponential p1t. Okay. So Va will have some part with exponential j omega t and some other part with exponential p1t. See, this exponential j omega t can never cancel that exponential p1t. Okay. So around each loop, the parts of the natural response have to balance themselves and the parts of the force response also have to balance themselves. Okay. So that's not a problem. But if the second thing I said is a little complicated, don't worry about it. Just assume that natural responses have died out. Okay. So VA plus VB plus VC is 0, right? So that actually means that these complex numbers VA plus VB plus VC themselves are 0, because this times exponential j omega t plus that exponential j omega t plus VC exponential j omega t is 0. But exponential j omega t is a common factor to all the voltages in the loop. Okay. So if you just look at these complex factors multiplying each voltage in the loop, they also sum to 0. Okay. There will be some quantities with dimensions of voltage and they will obey Kirchhoff's voltage law. Is this okay? Similarly, the currents at every node. So this is around loops and that this is at nodes. ID plus IC plus IE equals 0. So that means that ID plus IE plus IF is 0. ID plus IE plus IF, these complex numbers which are multiplying exponential j omega t, they themselves are 0. Okay. So you can think of these complex numbers, complex multiples themselves as currents. Okay. Remember, the actual currents are ID times exponential j omega t. But because that comes out as a common factor, we can remove that altogether. Is this okay? So clearly now you can imagine writing, let's say you are doing nodal analysis, writing KCL equations at every node. Okay? What will you have? You will have some matrix of entries, okay, corresponding to KCLs at node 1 and node n, okay, and every one of these entries will have exponential j omega t, okay, right? Every current will have exponential j omega t. So I can just take that thing outside, and this will be just a matrix of complex numbers. So let's say this is the modified nodal analysis setup. Okay, I am showing it in an abstract way. We'll see how to make it more concrete. Is this fine? And this will be equal to the source vector. And what is that in this particular case? I will put the source vector in the top, but you can put it anywhere. I mean, so I will assume there is only one source, but you can have multiple sources as long as they are all at the same frequency. Okay. So you agree? It's like this. Yeah. So let's assume just a single source. That is Vp exponential j phi times exponential j omega t. Huh? Oh yeah. By the way, actually maybe I shouldn't call this MNA setup. I assume that the currents were here. Okay. So let me not show this as a matrix, or rather I'll show it as a matrix, but let me see how best to do this, because we haven't yet come to the part where we can write it as a linear set of linear equations. So let me do it like this. Okay. So around node 1, let's say some okay, I will have it like this, right? And then somewhere, let's say I took the, in fact for simplicity let me make this a current source. Okay. So let me make it IP cos omega t plus phi, which makes it IP exponential j phi exponential j omega t for some particular node where the current source is connected. Let me call it node 2. Maybe I'll have something. So IX plus IY plus some other currents times exponential j omega t, where all these are just currents connected to the second node, equals IP exponential j phi exponential j omega t. Okay. So every entry on the left hand side will have exponential j omega t as common factor, and every source element will also have exponential j omega t as a common factor. Okay. So we can get rid of this altogether and write these KVL or KCL relationships only in terms of the complex multiples of exponential j omega t. Okay. Is this fine? And these complex multiples of j omega t, these are what are known as phasors. Okay. So as we go on, it is kind of quite common to say that, oh, the voltage across these two nodes is 1 plus J1 or something. But you should understand what that really means. What does it mean? Real part of what? So what it means is, if you apply the input and wait for a long time, if you apply a sinusoidal input, let's say Vp cos omega t plus phi, and wait for a long time, the actual voltage across that will be 1 plus J1 times exponential J omega t and the real part of that. Okay, so that's what it means, right? So you shouldn't forget that, although we will do all the manipulation in terms of phasors and talk as though the voltages are some complex constants. Okay, this is fine. The reason this is valid is because every voltage around the loop, every voltage around every loop has this exponential J omega t as a common factor. And every current at a node, arriving at a node, also has exponential j omega t as a common factor. So in circuit analysis, we can do all our calculations without this exponential j omega t. Okay? Is this fine? Next, what we have to do is to find the element relationships. Because how did we do any circuit analysis with KCL, KVL and element relationships? What we have shown so far is that in all our KCL and KVL equations, we can just remove this exponential j omega t and then move on. Okay? Then what do we do about element relationships? In fact, there are only like two special cases, right? You have a resistor and you have some VR exponential j omega t across it. What's the current through it? IR exponential j omega t. But what's the relationship between VR and IR? VR equals IR times R. Okay. So how did we get this actually? The actual voltage is something. Let's say I call this VR hat. Okay. And the current is IR hat cos omega t plus phi. Okay, so this IR is nothing but IR hat exponential j phi, and after that you will have exponential j omega t. So we know that VR hat is IR hat times R. Okay, so that's the conventional relationship for a resistor. Now when you have these complex voltages, the same relationship will hold, and this VR, the complex number, is nothing but VR hat exponential j phi. And after that, you will have this exponential j omega t. Okay. So clearly, you have the same exponential j phi here and there. Okay. So we are, this complex number is that complex number times R. Okay. So similarly, we can work out for a capacitor and inductor. We will do that tomorrow. No, VR hat and IR hat are real. They are the actual voltages, amplitudes of voltages across the resistor. So if the voltage across a resistor is some VR hat cos omega t plus phi, you know that the current is just that voltage divided by the resistance. Okay. So now whatever calculations we had to do with cosines and sines were too complicated. So we will translate everything into the exponential domain and then do it. Okay. Yes. Absolutely. Yeah. So this analysis, we will see. Right now we will assume only one source. And this analysis is valid only for that frequency. Okay, because all those complex numbers that we calculate will depend on the frequency as well. So we'll continue from here tomorrow and then look at element relationships and how to solve for circuits in general. Okay. Yesterday we started looking at sinusoidal steady state response of linear circuits, in particular how to calculate it for arbitrary circuits. Okay, so one method of course is to write the differential equation with the correct variable, and when you have say sinusoidal steady state response, you really find the response to exponential j omega t and take the real part. But we don't want to be writing differential equations every time. So So what we do is use the fact that if you have exponential j omega t as the excitation, every response in the circuit will be something times exponential j omega t, some complex number times exponential j omega t. Okay, so given that, this exponential j omega t comes out as a common factor. Okay, so yesterday I illustrated it with some circuit. So this is a linear circuit, and now of course it includes inductors and capacitors, and if you have a loop and you have, let's say, VA, VB and VC, and the excitation, let's say, is a, we can take a current or a voltage source, it doesn't matter, this is some IP cos omega t plus phi, which has been substituted by IP exponential j phi exponential j omega t. Okay, so now this is sinusoidal steady state analysis. At a frequency omega, that's crucial, right? We have this exponential j omega t here, or cos omega t plus phi. Now, as I said, the steady state response for of any quantity in the circuit will be of the form of some complex number exponential j omega t. I use this with an over bar, letters with an over bar to indicate that it's a complex number. Okay. And similarly, if you have a number of currents entering a node, ID, IE and IF, then each of those also is of the same general form. So now that means that every branch voltage and every branch current in the circuit has this exponential j omega t hanging off the expression. Okay. So instead of writing KVL around this loop as VA plus VB plus VC equal to 0, this is of course correct, we can instead use only this part of it, because the rest of it is a common factor anyway. So we can write the sum of these complex numbers VA, VB and VC to be 0. And these multipliers, these complex numbers which are multiplying exponential j omega t, are what are known as phasors. Okay. So this VA bar is the phasor corresponding to the voltage VA, VB bar for VB and so on, and similarly for currents. And of course now for currents we have to write KCL, which would have been ID plus IE plus IF being 0. Instead, we can simply write the sum of these complex numbers to be 0. Okay. So we can write KVL and KCL just in terms of these complex numbers instead of using the full time domain voltages. Okay. Any questions about this?
Sure.
Yeah.
Are these phasors the same kind of phasors that we use in phasor diagrams?
Yeah. These are the phasors. This is how they come about. Okay, you will see. So we will, because these are complex numbers, they have some amplitude and angle, we can make useful relationships on a phasor diagram. Okay, a complex number is nothing but a two-dimensional vector, right? So you can, on a two-dimensional plane, plot these things. So VA plus VB plus VC being 0 means that these three are part of a triangle. Okay, this fine? So now that simplifies our life somewhat, so we can get rid of this exponential j omega t and differential equations and so on. But the reason, first of all, why we had differential equation in the first place is because inductors and capacitors have current voltage relationships that have derivatives in them. Okay. So now what do we do about those? So let's see what happens in this phasor domain, as we call it. Okay. So let's say the voltage across this is Vr and the current is Ir, and Vr is some complex number exponential j omega t, and Ir is some other complex number exponential j omega t. Okay, so now Ohm's law of course says that Vr by Ir equals R if this resistance has a value R. And that consequently also means that the ratio of these complex numbers Vr bar divided by Ir bar equals also R. Okay, this is extremely simple. This is for a resistor. Now let's take a capacitor. Okay, I have Vc and Ic, and this is a capacitor C. So again, Vc is some Vc exponential j omega t, and Ic is Ic bar exponential j omega t. What is the relationship? Okay, so from this what do we have? What is it that we get out of this? Ic bar exponential j omega t, which is the current, is j omega c Vc bar exponential j omega t. Okay, so clearly the ratio of voltage to current phasors will be 1 by j omega c. Okay, so the key point here is that what was an integral or a derivative relationship has become an algebraic relationship, just like Ohm's law. Okay, that's the advantage of doing this. What is the limitation here? Can we use this everywhere? What is the context in which we can treat the voltage current ratio of a capacitor like this, like a number? What exponential? This is only for sinusoidal steady state. Okay, yeah, it is true for an exponential also, but this particular thing is for a sinusoidal steady state at a frequency of omega. Okay, if you had arbitrary waveforms for Vc and Ic, you had to relate them using the integral. Now it is sinusoidal, that means that there is a sinusoidal excitation of frequency omega, and it is steady state, that means that the natural response has died out. Okay, so that's the context in which this whole thing is useful. And similarly for an inductor, VL and IL, and this is an inductor L. So VL is VL bar exponential j omega t, and IL is IL bar exponential j omega t. And using the same relationship, VL is L times DIL dt, we get, what is the ratio of VL by IL? J omega L. Okay, isn't it? So now the advantage is that all of these, especially the more complicated elements like capacitor and inductor, also have a voltage current which are simply related by some ratio, constant ratio. Okay, so as far as analysis is concerned, you could treat them just like resistors. Okay, is this fine? So this is how, I think you probably are already familiar with phasors and how to use them for calculations, but this is how they come about. Because in sinusoidal, with sinusoidal excitation, you will get all of the waveforms everywhere in the circuit to be sinusoids of the same frequency. Okay, so now if you represent that, if you do the usual superposition and use exponential j omega t instead of cos omega t plus phi, everywhere you will have this exponential j omega t as a common factor. So you can drop that exponential j omega t from every voltage and current in the circuit and pretend that these numbers, which are phasors, themselves obey KVL and KCL. They do. Okay, but and also, as I said, as we go on, I keep saying that, oh, this Vr is the voltage and Ir is the current and so on. But what does it really mean? What is the voltage across the resistor? So it is the, if you apply a sinusoidal frequency omega, that means that the voltage across the resistor will be this complex number times exponential j omega t, the real part of that one. Okay, so that's the meaning of this whole thing. So So you should not lose connection to this. Although this is used so widely that after a while with this using this exponential jomega t will become second nature. Okay. So this is used everywhere in communication systems, in circuits. Okay.
Even if it is, if the voltage is e raised to omega t instead of j omega t, this will happen.
So if you use the exponential of st instead of omega t, this j omega will be replaced by s. Okay. So that is with, and s can be a general complex number. It doesn't have to be purely imaginary. An exponential st, if s is purely imaginary, that corresponds to this combination of sine and cos, right? Whereas if you have a complex exponential, you will have some exponential modulation as well. So you can use that. In fact, that is the basis for this Laplace transform analysis that you will see in the next semester. Okay.
Sir, so always resistors and capacitors can be replaced by, inductor and capacitor can be replaced by resistors.
Not a resistor. It's some, so the generic term for this, it is known as impedance. Impedance is basically the voltage by current phasor. Okay. For a resistor, obviously the impedance is R itself, because whatever value of whatever voltages and currents you have, the ratio is always R. And for a capacitor, it is 1 over j omega c or minus j over omega c. And for an inductor, it is j omega l. Okay. And it's common to represent this impedance by Z. Okay. The inverse of this, it's known as admittance. Okay. Which is Y, and that is I by V. It's the analogous quantity to conductance, and for this it is G, which is 1 by R, and this is J omega C, and 1 by J omega L or minus J by omega C. Okay. This is fine. Now we have only looked at resistors, capacitors and inductors. You can define the same now for any voltage and current. That is, let's say you have some any network with two terminals. You can take the voltage across it and the current going through it. So earlier we did this, right? We took a circuit whose two terminals were exposed, we applied a voltage and found the current, or somehow we know the voltage and the current. The ratio of that voltage to current was the equivalent resistance. Now I call it the equivalent impedance. Okay. And similarly, I by V would be the equivalent admittance. Okay. So now let's say inside this I have a series connection of R and L. What is the equivalent impedance? R plus j omega L. So you simply add up the impedances for series components. Similarly, for components in parallel, you add up the admittances and so on. Okay. So whatever you did with resistances, the same thing applies to impedances. Whatever you did with conductances, now it applies to admittances. Okay. The only caveat here is that the resistance and conductance are always real numbers, and for a physical resistance and conductance, they are always positive real numbers. Whereas this Z and Y, the impedance and admittance are complex numbers. Okay. So this impedance could have a real part as well as an imaginary part. And whereas the capacitor and inductor have a purely imaginary impedance. Okay. But in general, for a complicated network, you could have both real and imaginary parts. And the real part of this impedance is called resistance. Okay. And the imaginary part of this is called the reactance. Okay. So it's common to denote the reactance by X. Okay. What is the admittance of this? It's the reciprocal of R plus j omega L. I will rationalize it and write it as R square plus m h square L square minus j omega L by R square plus omega square L square. Okay. Now this is in the form of G plus JB, where G is the conductance. Which is the real part of the admittance. Okay. And this B, which is the imaginary part of admittance, this is known as susceptance. Okay. So in this case, this part omega L by R square plus omega square L square is B. So in general, these quantities R, L, X, G and B can all be frequency dependent. Okay. So in this case, you see that R is R by the G is frequency dependent. Okay. It depends on frequency. It is okay? No, the resistance of a resistor is frequency independent. The resistance of some complicated circuit, that's not frequency independent. Resistance by definition is the real part of the admittance. The real part of admittance is not necessarily frequency independent. The resistance of just a resistor, of course, is frequency independent.
But inductor and capacitor will always have
a reactance. Yeah, that's right. So their resistance will be zero. What is that?
Z equals R plus
jx. No, Z is R plus jx. What R and X are depends on what circuit is inside. Okay? I mean, in this case, I put a resistor and inductor in series. If I put something like this, what is it? You will get some complex quantity. Okay? So, the real part of Z is the resistance of that circuit. It's not the resistance that's physically inside. Okay, so maybe I confused the issue by starting with an example which had R and L in series, but maybe I should use a different symbol. So Z is some R plus JX. By definition, this is the real part of Z and this is the imaginary part of Z. Okay, so for that particular circuit, if you have, let's say, R1 and L1, this R plus JX happens to be R1 plus J omega L1. So the resistance of this network happens to be R1 and the reactance of this network happens to be omega L1. Okay. And similarly, Y is G plus JB. The conductance of this network is R1 by R1 plus omega square L1 square. What? R1 square. Yeah. Okay. And the susceptance B is minus omega L1 by R1 square plus omega square L1 square. Okay. So these are just definitions. Now every impedance has two constants inside. If you have only an inductor, then its resistance is 0 and the reactance is omega L. If you have only a capacitor, its conductance is 0 and the susceptance is omega C. Okay. And so on. Any questions about this? Yeah. If you have only a pure capacitance, the admittance is J omega C. Okay. So, if you write it as G plus JB, G is 0 and B is omega C. Right? If you have a purely imaginary admittance, then the conductance is 0. The conductance part is 0. Now, if I connect some resistance Rx across it, what will be the admittance? Rx plus J omega C. You can't add those things. Rx is a resistance, omega C has dimensions of conductance. It's 1 by Rx plus J omega C. You have to add the admittance of the resistor, which is 1 by Rx, and admittance of the capacitor, which is J omega C. Okay. So in this case, G is this and B is that. Okay. Any other questions? So now, this is a great simplification, okay? The fact that voltage and currents are related by some ratio, some constant number, that's a great simplification. And it enables us to analyze circuits in sinusoidal steady state very easily, okay? Okay, so this we could do in various ways by writing out the differential equations and assuming solutions of the form A times cos plus B times sine, or expanding the cosine in terms of complex exponentials, or the most convenient one, which was to replace this with Vp exponential j phi exponential j omega t and solving the differential equation with this. In this case, it was particularly easy because the exponential j omega t gave solutions also of the form exponential j omega t. But now we don't even need to do this. Okay. So what we do is, everywhere we calculate only the phasors. Once we have the phasors, we know what the real voltage is. In terms of complex exponential, it's that phasor times exponential j omega t. So you should be given the value of frequency. Okay. So it's a function of omega. Okay. Now, in the actual domain, that is in the actual time domain corresponding to this circuit, it will be that phasor times exponential j omega t, the real part of that whole product. Okay. So what is the phasor corresponding to the voltage source? What is this? Vp exponential j phi. Okay. So this is how phasors are usually written. Okay. So there is a further shorthand to this. Normally you write it maybe as Vp angle phi. Okay, so that's supposed to mean Vp exponential j phi. It's a complex number. Alternatively, you could also write it as Vp cos phi plus j Vp sin phi. Okay, now for us, cos omega t is the reference. If phi is 0, that means that Vp angle, the phasor will be Vp angle 0. The phasor will be a real number. Okay, and if you want Vp sin omega t, what is the phasor corresponding to this? Vp pi by 2? Phi is pi by 2? Minus pi by 2, right? Vp angle minus pi by 2, Vp exponential minus j pi by 2. Any which way you can write a complex number, you can write the phasor, right? So this is known as the rectangular form, this is the polar form, and this is some more compact representation of the polar form. Okay, so the complex number has some amplitude and angle or magnitude and phase. So the magnitude of that is the peak value of the sinusoid. Okay, the angle of that is the phase of that sinusoid with respect to cos omega t. Okay, you can only measure phase difference, right? You have to have some reference signal. The reference signal for us is cos omega t. Okay. So, a signal, when you have a phasor of this, that means that in the actual circuit, you had a signal which is something like this, where this is phi. Okay. So, the point is, it's just some complex number, and then we have R and we have C. Basically, this is like having an impedance. This is the generic term, a generic symbol for an impedance, a box with two wires hanging off it. And the impedance has a value 1 by j omega C. Okay. Now, because the ratio of voltage to current is just some number, every technique that you had for analyzing only resistive circuits, you can use here. Okay. So, for instance, if I had R1 and R2 and Vp angle phi, what's the voltage across this? It's R2 by R1 plus R2 times that voltage. And if you had these impedances Z1 and Z2 instead, what would it be? Exactly the same, right? With Z replacing R. So what is it in this case? So it is Z2 by Z1 plus Z2 times VP angle phi, and this can also be simplified as or rewritten as 1 by 1 plus j omega cr times VP angle phi. And when you solve the differential equation, if you recall, you had that VP exponential st getting multiplied by 1 by 1 plus scr. Okay, that's exactly what we have here with s substituted by j omega. Okay, so this does give you the right answer. Now, why is this useful? This is useful because let's say you apply a sinusoidal voltage to a circuit. Initially, there will be some transient response. After that, the transient response will die out, assuming that the system is stable. And after that, you will get only the steady state response. Okay. So now this is a straightforward way, more straightforward way of calculating the steady state response compared to solving the differential equation. Okay. In fact, we don't have to write the differential equations at all. We saw that first order was very easy, second order was slightly more complicated. For higher orders, it's a bit more complicated. Okay. Whereas in this case, I mean, in this particular example, I have one capacitor, but I could have 100. That's not a problem, right? Okay. Any questions?
So we take the real part of this to get
answer. Real part of what? Not real part of this, but what should we do to get the actual voltage across this steady state voltage? So I have to multiply this by exponential j omega t and take the real part of that whole thing. That will be the voltage here after you wait a long enough time. Okay, you have to wait long enough time so for the natural response to die out. Okay, so like I said, there is no life as electrical engineer without complex numbers, so we will use phasors all over the place, but you shouldn't lose connection to the actual voltages and currents in the circuit. Okay, now also you see that these numbers, the numbers that are multiplying the voltage etc., are frequency dependent. Okay, so when you have capacitors and inductors, you can have circuits that behave differently at different frequencies. That's actually a nice feature. So you could design circuits that will behave some way, maybe that will block certain frequencies, that will allow some other frequencies and so on. That's how we make filters. Okay, we'll see some examples of that later. Any other questions about this? How would you go about solving something like this? What's that?
1 ampere.
Yeah, 1 ampere, yeah. Oh, this is a current source. Okay. Supposed to be a current source like that. Okay. How would you go about solving this? Huh? Superposition. Okay. What other techniques do we know? Substitution. Of what? Not an equivalent. I want everything here, right? Let's say I want the voltage across this, voltage across that, everything. Oh. Huh? Two port. Actually, two port is the wrong thing, right? You won't know anything inside the two port. Two port is an abstraction for what's happening outside. What did we do when we wanted a general solution to a circuit? This is only the forced response. Okay, I'm not going to say this every time, but yeah, in this case, it's the sinusoidal steady state response I'm looking after. Yeah, so we have things like modified nodal analysis, right? Whatever we did for resistive circuits, we can do it here. Okay, so please do that. Please set up the, so let me say this is the reference node. Actually, there are only two voltages, V1 and V2, except of course, each one will be a phasor now. Okay, because the voltage across the inductor is V1 minus V2. And okay, you also have this, if you set it up as MNA, let's say V3. So please set up the modified nodal analysis stuff. This is also a good opportunity to revise all those things we learned long back. Okay. What I want is, now I will call this Y matrix, it's the admittance matrix instead of conductance, times the vector of unknown voltages, okay, which is equal to the source vector. Okay, with the usual caveat that the source vector doesn't have to be only currents and the unknown vector doesn't have to be only voltages. Okay, so please do this. Obviously, you have to use the impedances and admittances of different elements in this. Okay, admittances really, right, in a nodal analysis setup.
KVL and KCL, right? Or you can use nodal analysis where you don't define this auxiliary variable, you do it with only two variables, P1 and V2. You can convert this to Norton or that to Thevenin. And so many ways to do that. Okay, you can do it with Meissner algorithm. So everything that we did earlier with resistors, we can do. So I'm not going to go into many more details of nodal and mesh analysis because that's a routine algorithm. The only thing is, in the admittance matrix, you have admittances instead of conductances. Similarly, for mesh analysis, you use impedances instead of resistances. Okay? But there was also a number of other things we did initially with circuit analysis. What was that? Thevenin's theorem. You jumped straight into it. Okay?
Thevenin's theorem and some associated theorems, okay, reciprocity theorem, maximum power transfer theorem, all those things we can discuss with this in the sinusoidal steady state case, okay, and then see what comes about. In some cases it may be different from others and so on, okay. And we can have essentially mostly what happens is that wherever you had real numbers before, you will end up with complex numbers. Some results will be quite interesting as well, okay. And we can have everything like two ports with complex parameters and so on. Okay, in fact, now it should be clear why it's called Y parameters, not G, right? Y stands for admittance. So currents as functions of voltages, all those quantities will be admittance. So in the general case, it's called Y parameters. Similarly, the ones where you had resistances, that was called Z because Z is for impedance. Okay. Any questions about any of this? Yeah. Oh, that's not a linear circuit. We can't use any of this, right?
So, this
No. I mean, you can analyze it in any way you want, but your question is different. If I put a diode here, that's a nonlinear circuit. So, I'll have to analyze it as a nonlinear circuit. Okay. Any questions about this? Frequencies of which? That's a very interesting question. So let's say this was cos omega 1 t and this was omega 2 t. Okay. I still want to find the steady state voltages across all the elements. What should I do? I have to use superposition. Okay. So I have to superpose cases where I have voltages of or excitations of one particular frequency only and another particular frequency. Okay, and then calculate them separately. Now then I can add the final voltages, that is final voltages which are in the time domain. So I take, first of all, from the first set, I calculate the phasors times exponential j omega 1 t. This will give me some voltage, let's say across this capacitor. And in the second case, I get real part of V exponential j omega 2 t. Okay, that will give me some other voltage. Those two voltages I can add up. Okay, but when I'm doing sinusoidal steady state analysis, I have to take one frequency at a time. Okay. Any other questions? I thought somebody asked something here. No. So let's try another small problem. I think you may have solved this in one of the earlier tutorials, I don't remember. So, okay. Now, forget all this phasor analysis, phasor, sinusoidal, steady state analysis, all of this. Just from the fundamental relationship, I equals C dV by dt, you calculate this. Okay. So maybe these three rows please do it for this excitation and these two please do it for 1 milliamp sine 10 to the 3 t. Okay. Zero. The initial condition on the capacitor is zero. Okay. So what I want is to solution for t greater than 0. Okay. So please do it for one half of you do it for cos, the rest of you do it for sine. Extremely easy, right? And please tell me the solution. I think this was in the first tutorial or something of the sort. The solution to this, in this case, we see happens to be what? 1 minus cos 10 to the 3 t volts. Okay. And in this case, sine 10 to the 3 or 3 t volts. Okay. Fine. What is the phasor corresponding to this? What is the phasor corresponding to that? 1 milliamp cos 10 to the 3 t. What is the phasor? 1 milliamp. Omega is, of course, 10 to the 3. What is the impedance of this at that frequency? 1 over j omega c, which is minus j 10 to the, okay, ohms. Again, don't forget the units, right? And this current times voltage is the, current times impedance is the voltage. So what is the, first let me list out the inputs and outputs. When it was 1 milliamp cos 10 to the 3 t, the output was sine 10 to the 3 t, and the input in terms of phasors was 1 milliamp, angle 0 if you want to be explicit, and this times minus j 10 to the 3 ohms, this should have been how much? Minus j volts, okay, at that frequency. And when you have this other one, 1 milliamp sine 10 to the 3 t, the actual voltage is 1 minus cos 10 to the 3 t volts. So what is the phasor corresponding to this input? So minus j 1 milliamps, okay, and that times the impedance, which is minus j 10 to the 3 ohms, minus j 1 kilo ohm, should be how much? Minus plus 1 or minus 1? Minus 1 volts. Okay. So now, the what you calculate from the time domain and using phasor analysis, are they consistent? Yes. So sine 10 to the 3 t is minus j volts. That's right. Okay. What about this? Here I got minus 1 volt and there I've got something else. What is the time domain voltage corresponding to this phasor? If the phasor is minus 1 volt, what is the voltage? Minus cos omega t, omega here is 10 to the 3 volts. But I've got something extra here, why is that? So, I mean, this sinusoidal steady state analysis is supposed to be useful, right? What happened here? Please think about it, we'll discuss it tomorrow. It's not very difficult.